Good evening, Trinidad Tobago. Welcome to another edition of Scoreboard here on ACT and Axe 25. It's always a pleasure. We are always on between the hours of 8 to 9, and you can catch us right here. The Olympics have come. It has ended. We got one medal, thanks to Keyshawn Walcott. But how many of you know that Trinidad and Tobago will be sending three athletes to the Paralympics, which is also in Rio? And tonight we're going to be talking to one of those athletes, the young lady who a very interesting story, and she's going to be telling us about her first Olympic Paralympics. So we're going to take a short break. When we return, we go straight into tonight's discussion, Paralympics Rio 2016. Stay tuned, we'll be right back after the short break.
Welcome to the Premier Herbal Health Food Store, your source for all things herbal, natural and organic, making your health and well-being our highest priority. Carrying a diverse array of health products for enhancing your well-being, weight loss, sports nutrition and even increasing your daily energy levels. Questions? We've got helpful and knowledgeable herbalists to give you answers. Stop in and talk to our experienced herbalists. We are Herbs and Health.
Welcome back, Trinidad Tobago. Welcome back to Scoreboard, and I'm your host, George Matheson. As I said before the break, we're going to be talking Paralympics, because from the 7th of September to the 17th, Rio de Janeiro, we're going to be filled with a lot of athletes who will be taking part in that Olympics. And today we have, I have to make sure I get the name correct. Yeah? So, Nyosha
yes.
Kane, and better known as Hurricane Nayo. It's a pleasure. Welcome to ACTN.
Thanks for being here.
And we have her coach, Mickey Rubel. And I think this might be the closest I'm going to get to somebody who has associated himself with Usain Bolt, because he shared a good relationship, and we will touch a bit about that on tonight's program. It's a pleasure.
It's always a pleasure.
Now, as I said, we went to the Olympics. We came back with one bronze medal. Another Olympics is around the corner, but you are not hearing, you are not seeing the hype that was there for that last Olympics. Now, I'm putting the question out to both of you all. Do you think enough is being done for athletes who are going to the Paralympics or any Paralympics tournament that they may be? I don't know who wants to start.
All right, well, I could kick it off. As far as public awareness for the Paralympics, that's almost non-existent. There's a few media houses now, you know, like yourselves, trying to get the awareness going on, because as it stands now, this Paralympics might be the only opportunity that Trinidad and Tobago gets to hear their anthem play at the Olympics this year. Mm-hmm. And going into this meet, I think it should have more being done, because we have a triple world record holder in Akeem Stewart who will be competing in two events, the javelin and the discus, at the Paralympics. We have Nyosha Kane, who have run some of the fastest times in history this season. And then we have Chantel going into this competition. So I think while riding on the little bit of press that the previous Olympics get, I think it should have more done to just transition over from the Olympic Games into the Paralympic Games. Otherwise, it'd be doing the athletes competing at these Games an injustice.
Yeah, I quite agree with you. Nayo, can I call you Nayo?
Yes.
Right. Now, a very impressive profile here. In 3 years that you have taken up the sport, you are the double gold medal in 2014 in Mexico, a third and fifth place in 2015, and you repeat in 2016 in the USA, gold in the 100 and 200. Tell me a bit about yourself, and how did you decide I'm going to start in athletics, 100 meters, 200 meters?
Well, I used to run. I think everybody used to run when they were in primary school.
Yeah.
You start off at primary school level.
Mm.
I continued in secondary school level, and I quit after that because I had a partner, I would say, or friend, who used to do track with me as well, competing at school level, which was Kenesha Spann.
Yes,
she's also a national athlete. And we competed together when we went to Mobile Avenue, competing in school at the school level. And when she left that Mobile Avenue, I quit track. And I went on to volleyball. From that, I went to a sports camp that the ministry had in UE. And from that sports camp, I was there working and doing track in the deep track and field department. And, you know, I just found that passion again to run, you know, and I said, okay, in September coming, I will join a club. When I joined the club, it was nice, but the pains wasn't nice. So I decided to, you know what, I'll quit. And then I went back to beach volleyball. I was in indoor volleyball, and then I moved to beach volleyball after track. And the coach there, Anthony Spencer, he's the coach of Cougars in Arima.
Yeah.
And he called me back, and he said, I have an opportunity for you, and, you know, I would like you to come, and I'll speak with you about it. So I went, and upon going, he said, I have an offer for you to go and join the Paralympics. So started hear some crickets. I don't know what Paralympics is all about. When I heard Paralympics, automatically Special Olympics came into my head.
Yeah.
But I didn't really hesitate not going. I went, and we spoke to the president at that time, which was Ken McKell. And when we spoke with him, he was interested in getting me on board. So we started to train, and from there, track was it?
And you have not looked back since?
No, I haven't.
How did the relationship between yourself and your coach develop?
Mickey Rubin?
Yeah.
It was the same, how to put this? Right. I was training with Anthony Spencer, but he could not have, where I saw myself, in track and field.
Yeah, he couldn't carry there.
He couldn't carry me there. So I needed someone to take me to that level.
Mm-hmm.
And I spoke with Kenesha Spann, and she said, well, my coach could help you. You know, you could call him, and he could talk to you and think, we're going training later. We could go together and stuff. I said, all right, no problem. I went to the training, not knowing who this Mickey Rubin is. I don't know him, never seen him before, because I'm new to track.
Mm.
Went to training, and he said, you have three 300s, but after the 300s, you have to run the stairs in Atabolan. So it's like...
You mad?
Yeah, like, I'm not doing that.
Yeah.
I could do the 300, but not the stairs. Mm-hmm. I'm not doing that. So when I realized this 300 is not an easy 300, and then the stairs.
Mm.
After the 300, I went to the bathroom. I disappeared. there was no turning back.
Mm-hmm.
Eventually, the pressures of really needing a coach came on, because the coach, I switched from Anthony Spencer to a Cuban coach called, by the name of McDoney Martin, right? He's under the Cuban program developing Trinidad athletes. And he at all could not take me where I needed to go, because I lacked competition and I lacked races. I lacked a whole lot of
technique. Yeah.
So I needed to go further. And I got braved, and I called Mickey Rubin, and I told him, I'd like to join the club and stuff. He's like, well, I only take serious people, you know.
Mm.
I was like, okay. He's like, well, send me all your information and the times you're running and your schedule and stuff. Because at that time, I was going to Open Bible Institute of Theology And that's in the evening, and I was working at the Ministry of Health. Mm. So my training hours had to be like early in the morning. And he picked up the challenge. It wasn't as the starting was very rough because his program is not a jokey program. It's rigid. Mm-hmm. But I think after a while we started to mesh and everything became cool.
How soon afterwards was your first major tournament, championships?
Well,
how long after joining the club?
After joining, okay.
Yeah.
It was like probably 3 months apart.
I can see after October, 6 months.
Yeah.
Roughly 6 months.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it after joining the club, 6 months after, that's your major, that's the
World Champs.
In Mexico.
That's in 2015.
No, that's World Championship.
That's World Championship.
Oh, that's the one in, where you came third and fifth.
Yes.
Tell me about the build up, because you join a club. Mm-hmm. You have no technique. There's no nothing about the fundamentals in track and field, mm-hmm. right? And you have 6 months in which to qualify for a tournament. How was that training for you before, and when you discovered, okay, I'm making my first major tournament, what was that feeling like?
What I remember was doing a lot of background work. Mm. And he told me, you have to run for senior champs. I was like, but I never run in Trinidad before. Mm. So I was like, I was really, really nervous. So I didn't even think I performed well, but he's like, oh, you ran good. And I was like, okay, really? All right. Mm. So he's like, no, you are where I need you. That's a statement all the time. You're where I need you to be. Mm. So if I have no worries, you shouldn't worry.
Okay.
So I was like, okay.
Very comforting words.
Yes, yeah. No problem. So we did a lot of background work. It wasn't much technical work, but a lot of background work to make sure because we had a short space of time to get to at least get in our top three spot. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I didn't really have a lot of conditioning. So that's why my 200 would not have been I wanted to be.
Yeah.
But the work that we did was sufficient enough to qualify.
Going to that tournament, what would you say the experience, what you brought back that have you today and the following years being double gold medalists in the 100 and 200? I know you came back and got back into the regime and doing things, but what part of that experience that you took coming third and fifth that maybe, if I should use the word, motivated you to grow and to, you know, become now the double medalist?
Well, I would say firstly is that's like my first competition where I saw different aspects of old Paralympians. Mm. You saw the wheelchair, you saw the people with one hand, some with no hand, and they that's like not coming third and fifth. That it's a good achievement, but to see where people with disability and what they could do and how far they could reach in life, I would say that was something I went home with, because when I grew up, people used to say, oh, look, hop and drop. Oh, look, this one, look at your foot, like this and thing. And I always used to feel that I never make myself so, but I wish I wasn't born. Mm-hmm. Because having to walk around and people telling you, look how you're walking, and look how you're looking, and it wasn't no motivation to do anything. Mm-hmm. But coming back from that and even achieving what I have achieved there, mm-hmm. it made me realize, okay, I could do anything that I put my mind to do, disability, no disability, specially impaired, visually impaired. You can do whatever you want to do.
Miki, when you first laid eyes on her, what was the first thing that came to mind? Because I guess that you'll be dealing with somebody with a disorder for the first time. Am I correct?
Yes.
Right? After the first maybe two trainings or three trainings, with the experience you have, what made you realize there's a world champion?
Right, well, as far as what I saw when I saw for the first time would be the same thing that I see today.
Mm.
Right? It makes my life easy when I look at things like this. I see an athlete. Right? Because I always dissect any athlete that come to me in terms of an athlete that requires components. Just like a race car, you carry it into the shop. If your car accelerates too slow, you put on turbochargers. You need to cover more distance, you put on bigger wheels. Mm-hmm. So when I look at somebody come to me, I wouldn't see a disability.
Mm-hmm.
I just see somebody with components, mm-hmm. and I'll try to find the components that needs, that mm-hmm. you need to mm-hmm. improve to where you want to go.
Okay.
Right? So that's the main thing I saw when I saw her. As far as the performances that I was looking at to see that she's a world championship, mostly I look at your mental positioning. If it is you survive my workouts and you still come back for an next helping, then you have what I want.
And she survived the first workout.
Right. She kind of survived the first workout, but she came back for an next helping.
Not the first one where she ran and hide.
Because most person don't survive my first
workout. Where she duck and run.
Right.
Yeah.
I had somebody came and do drills with me one day and threw up.
Mm.
Right. So I just need to know that you're willing to put your body through what's necessary to get your performance parts installed.
Mm.
And from the time I saw that, I was like, hey, this is going to be nice. Because as I tell everybody who would ask the question, what do I expect? My statement is always the same thing. I expect her to be the best ever in her class in this sport.
Mm.
Right? And those are not words you could use lightly because you have to back that up.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I'm gonna give you a secret. Nobody have ever said me said this before except for my wife.
Okay. First time I was 25? Yeah.
Yes. I don't think that I am the best coach in the world. I don't have the best programs in the world. I can't write the best programs.
Mm.
But because I believe that God writes my programs. When I look at somebody, it takes me less than 3 minutes to make an assessment, and that's not because of my skill.
Yeah.
Right? I have 21 years experience, but that's not my skill. Right, when I look at you, I start to say, oh, you need this, you need that, you need that, you need that. Right? And the programs, as crazy as they might sound, are geared to what somebody needs.
Mm.
Right? And that's divine, that's not me.
Mm.
So the statement is simply to my wife, I'm only successful because God write my programs. And the closer my athletes are to God, because every day when training done, we have to come together and pray. If you miss it, I'm calling you back.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Because it's as simple as that. The closer you all are to God, is the faster you all succeed and the further you all reach makes my work easier. So I recommend all my athletes go to church and stuff like that.
Mm.
So I don't have to be good. I just have to show up and look.
In the 3 years that she has been running, I mean, double gold medalist on two occasions, where do you see her in the next 3 years?
All right. In the next 3 years, I expect that she would have run a couple of world records in both events. I expect that she would be one of the biggest ambassadors for a sport that this country ever seen. She would pull a lot of people out who would normally think that they were less than or substandard and let them come to the forefront to make this country proud.
Mm-hmm.
I think that she would make inroads into assisting her association in filling some gaps. I expect that sponsors would start to come out and start to support her sport just for the way that she operates and the way that she carries about herself. Because if you would realize with plenty sports people these days, right, apart from their ability and their talent, when people look out, they have to look and see somebody of integrity.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Plenty of the top ones, you kind of miss that. So nobody wants to get involved with their sport because of that. But except her, outgoing personality, I think that she has that kind of integrity that, you know, and she learns very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
I believe in producing complete athletes and complete human beings. So which means if somebody puts a camera in your face, you mustn't be stumbling and don't know what to say.
Yes.
Right? Yeah. If somebody asks you a question about your country,
must be able to
you should be able to represent your country, because after you reach a certain level, you are no longer you. You are ambassador. And when you become a public figure, you have to be able to represent your country, your church, your faith, your sport, your association at any given time. Mm. Right? And I see her as being one of the people that will do that for para track and field, not for just Trinidad, right, but in this region, right? So that's basically some of what I see. If I sit down to say all that I see, you know, she will get frightened and then you will start knocking and wonder if she could fit in the shoes that I have for her, right? And some of the stuff I would say to some of my athletes is, anytime you're worried about anything, just forget about looking at yourself in the mirror. Just look at yourself through my eyes and you will see what I see. And then you will have to worry about anything.
I want to talk a bit about your track club, but before we get there, let's talk about the preparation that is in place right now for the Olympics. Because I want to make it known to the viewing public is that you're not going out there just to run against somebody with a disorder. Just as how you have the determination and the drive to succeed, you're going to be meeting people outside there who have that same drive, who have that same determination to go out and succeed. So you cannot sit and say, okay, back-to-back gold and silver, a shorter beat everybody in Rio. It can't be like that. You don't even know what you're going out there to meet. Now, this is your first Olympics. You have to be prepared to run.
Yes.
You also have to be prepared mentally to deal with a big occasion, because this is going to be a big occasion. People can say what they want, right? They might want to say, okay, the last Olympics, that is it. No, this is also a big occasion. What is the preparation like from now until when you leave?
Well, I leave within a week's time.
The preparation for me basically is to really be focused, have less to do with, less to deal with in terms of school, because I'm going to a new school in September. So have less to deal with, just focus on track, having myself mentally prepared, physically prepared, spiritually prepared most of all, and just relax and get the show.
Well, what's your training schedule like now, every day, hours? What sort of, you know, is it strength? Is it, you know, what is your training schedule?
Well, Monday, Wednesday, and
Friday is
junior morning time
from
5:30 to about 7:00.
I have
so half 5 in the morning,
yeah.
You're already up.
Okay. Yeah,
so I have gym.
From gym,
I go home, take a rest, come down to Maribella, train again.
Where are you coming from?
From Lavantil.
Right, so you're traveling from Lavantil to, right, okay. I just want the viewers to be aware of the sacrifice that is being made.
Yes.
From Lavantil to Maribella for 3. And then we finish about, well, these days we finish about 5:00 for the latest.
And you travel or you have your?
No, I drive.
Okay.
Right.
Mm.
But before this stage, like a month ago, I was working. So within that slot, so it's from 5:30 to about 7:00, get ready for work. From work, come to training.
Beat all that traffic coming down south?
Well, we used to go to either Chagonas.
Okay.
Or some of the days I will have to cut my gym program and go to UE to train. So, and then I was going to school. So, have school in the evening from about, Sheldon will know, from about 9:30 for the latest. And then repeat the program again. So it was really tough. But now it's a bit more calm because I sacrificed my job to, you know, focus more on track and field, because I believe this is where God will have me at this point in time.
Yeah.
And I will follow that. And I could say that now I have no worries in terms of financially. I have no worries, you know, because I don't think God will lead you to a path and he will leave you there to hang and, you know, it's like, why do this and why do that? But once he leads you down the road, he always prepares and put things in on that pathway so that everything could fall into place.
Speed Factory Track Club, tell us a bit about this club.
All right, well, Speed Factory Track Club was basically formed out of necessity. Right, because when I returned from Jamaica 3 years ago, I had no intention of forming a club because personally I believe that Trinidad has too much clubs, right? But because I just wanted to pass my information on to whichever coach would listen to help them get to that next level, I'm realizing that everybody guarded their thing like a personal secret, right? I spoke to Brent Clark, who's a friend of mine from track and field days way back, right? And we decided, let's try and lead by example, right? Because anybody who's willing to hear, we're willing to teach them what's going on. But right, so when we started this club, it was just a few athletes, you know, people like Renee Studdard, right, Marisha Arthur, Kanisha Arthur's sister. Then there was a couple of guys on point, like Kevin Roberts and some of these guys, Johnny Manis, who were the initial athletes in the club, Anton Roberts. Right, we started this club so that we could put athletes to a higher level. I didn't really want to be coaching kids or anything like that, right? But as you move along, you get to realize that if you don't start your own development, I don't want to seem as a poacher where you go and look for people, athletes, to put them to that next level, right? But the thing is, one of the problems that plenty clubs have that I don't want to fall into is that the athlete to coach ratio, right? You need to have people who you can trust and know what they're doing, or people who would listen and willing to learn to get them up. Speed Factory is the only club in the country that can boast that every season, every athlete in the club has run a personal best. For the past 2 years that the club is officially open.
Okay.
Right? And that every athlete from Trinidad and from that went to represent Trinidad and Tobago from Speed Factory has a medal.
Okay.
Right? So Kevin has gone to Curfta, you have a Curfta gold and a record in the heptathlon. Renee Studdard and Jindai Noel has relay medals at Curfta. Ayoka Cummins, who was a member of the club that represented UTT.
Yeah,
right. She have a Curfta relay medal. Nayosha, who went to the World Championships, has a medal. So everybody has a medal, right? And that's about mentality. That's what the club preaches. Basically, most athletes in Trinidad, when you make a national team, you have completed your goal, right? And I don't push that, right? Your goal is to go and get a medal where you're going. I'm not saying that you would, but that's supposed to be your goal. You get to the finals and you attempt to get
somewhere. Yeah, sometimes you hear, you know, at least, well, I'm contented, I made a final, but is a final your ultimate goal?
Exactly. You know? Even if you have to aim for something high, so even if you drop short, you would have already done something that is a big accomplishment, right? There's lots of athletes like that compete at the regular Olympics that's gone, that regardless of no medal or not, I think that they had pushed themselves to a high standard, and I would take my hats off to them. Some, not so much, you know? But as far as the club is concerned, that's what I want to do. I try and keep the club as small as possible for the mere fact that the people with the mentality that we want always overwhelms the new ones that come in.
Okay.
So you don't bring bad habits.
Yeah.
That takes over the entire club. You have good habits that takes over the new ones that come in. Right, so basically that's the goal of Speed Factory. And once we get to a level that people could understand that this is what you need to do and this is how you need to do it, right? Because people keep talking about what Jamaica have and what Jamaica is producing, right? Jamaica produces a lot more top class athletes for two main reasons. And no matter who want to dress it up with political speaking, it's two simple things. It's mentality, because for them, this is a way out and a way of life. Trinidad, it's a pastime. That's one, right? The second thing is they have a better system of finding the talent, because they target, the whole thing starts from the schools. When you go to a track meet in Jamaica, there's 75 heats in one age group. In Trinidad, you'll find 8, right? And as far as I'm concerned, Jamaica has more of what we call rocks. Rocks is athletes who don't really amount to nothing, or you pop down and can't really perform well. Jamaica have more of that than Trinidad. But guess what? If you have 75 heats and you find one good one out of each heat, you find 75 good ones. Trinidad have 8 heats, you find 8 good ones. And then when you pull the 75 good ones and you put them into heats, you'll probably get another 8 heats where you find one exceptional one, right? And Trinidad, you will find one. So you have 8 exceptional to post to one. And when you put the 8 of them in one heat and you fire the gun, you find one world beater. So every class, you would find one world beater for every 75 people you run. Trinidad find one good one, one world beater. So when Jamaica would find 8 good ones to replenish their ranks,
we
found one.
Yeah.
And it's so few and far between that it looks like we're not trying. It's just that we have them out there, but the system in which you use to find them is not proper.
Right? You are sacrificing your life. What's your organization? What sort of help are you, you know, do you qualify for elite funding? Are you being offered anything, you know?
I will answer by saying, no, we are not qualified for elite funding.
And that is based on your approach to them, right?
Yeah, we have asked, we've inquired, and we are not qualified for elite funding.
Did they say why?
They said it's because cabinet hasn't ruled us as elite athletes, right? And we do not qualify for elite funding.
Am I getting myself in trouble? But that sounds like biasness.
And we only qualify, we could get
grant funding. We could get funding, but it's like a grant funding, which would not be as what you are entitled to. Because at this stage, I am a world class athlete, and I'm ranked, in my class, I am ranked top 3, right?
And in the world?
In the world.
Okay.
Right? I'm first in the Caribbean Americas.
Right.
Right? And they told me, no, you're not qualified. You'll have to get grant funding and we'll see what we could do. Yes, I've received the grant funding, but
I'm just answering your question. You know,
we're not qualified.
Before I come to the one, is the grant funding sufficient to take care of your needs? Because as an athlete, there are a lot of things you need. You need nutrition, you know, you need a lot of things. Is that funding adequate, or do you have to source outside for assistance?
No, I would say it's not adequate, because if I do decide to go to all the meets that were scheduled for the year with the grant funding that was given, then I may have end up just probably going two.
Okay.
Right? I might go two, but still when I come back, have to struggle to get through the rest of the year, right? I do have extra source of incomes where people would, because I'm in church and, you know, church communities, they help.
Yeah.
And then I also get help from a guy named Mr. Douglas. He's the owner of Ozone Water Limited. So he helps me out a lot. So I
get help from the public, okay. Right?
But to say from
the government, yes, I do get help, but it's not sufficient.
Okay, you wanted to say something.
Yeah, as far as this is one of the things that I kind of try and pay attention to and want to hear what the responses are about it. Because what classes you as an elite athlete? To be elite, you have to be on the higher end of the sword in your sport in the world, not in your country or whatever.
That would be the top 3 or the top 4, whatever it is.
As far as...
But she's in the top 3.
As far as this criteria goes for the regular athletes, you have to be top 40 in the world to qualify for elite funding in an individual event.
Okay.
Right? When you get up to where the air is rare, like top 10 and stuff, you are entitled to the maximum allowable as far as elite funding is concerned. She's top 3. If they get a medal at an Olympics, be it bronze or silver or whatever it is. Like, for instance, the 2008 Olympics, when they came home, there was a big hoopla
Richard got was the $1 million man. He got $1 million for two silvers. Mm. The rest of the team got, I think, $700,000+. What was your bronze medal at World Championship worth?
Nothing.
Not even a congratulations. Nobody came to the airport and took a picture. You understand? That's what it's equal to, right? I believe that if you're trying to have a society where everybody works together, you have to make people feel equal, yeah. Right? Because as a para athlete, it's more expensive to train with a whole lot less sponsorship.
And I would think, not cutting either, but I would think it's a bit harder to train too, because with whatever disorder you have, there is some measure of discomfort doing the normal exercise. Yeah. If I am normal, okay, I get pain, right? But disorders, there's gonna be some discomfort. So,
I can give you an example of that. Like how I normally, how I structure my programs, anytime I have 2 days of hard workouts back to back, there is 3 days where she needs to recover, do therapy, all kind of stuff, because of the disparity in the size of pizza.
That's what I'm getting at.
Back pains, ankle pains. Mm. Like the meet that we went in Arizona, we had to find our own funding. And that meet cost $23,000. Because normally with regular athletes, when they go to Grand Prix meets, the meet organizers pay airfare, accommodation, food, ground transportation, all of that stuff. Mm. In para, there is none. And you have no choice when you're preparing because you have to fly out. Like even the Olympic team that is leaving, the team have to be skeleton down because of how IPC have their thing set up. You're only allowed to X amount of people. So right now there's one track coach, there's a physio, a swimming coach, the three athletes and the president, and that's it. Right? There's no massage therapist. Like normally what she was referring to when we travel, that she have a therapist and a coach and whatever, is because I am qualified to do all. So she have a manager, a coach, or whatever. So I have to be walking about with lots of hats, right? But as it stands, it takes a team, right, to make an athlete perform. You understand what I'm saying? And when you have to go to a meet somewhere and you have to try and find money for that team, what's going to happen if I couldn't do everything? So which means you have to make a choice whether what's needed most. I'm sure everybody watches Usain Bolt and love to see Usain Bolt run. But if you go on his Facebook page or his WhatsApp, his Instagram and stuff like that, when he steps off of the plane, you see Ricky Simms walk. So
that's his agent. I checked that recently.
Right, you see that's his personal assistant. You see Everett Edwards come on, that's his massage therapist. He has his support system, because that's what it requires to perform. And if you have to pay for that out of your pocket to go wherever you have to go, then everybody's going to stay home all the time. Right, we are very thankful to the Ministry of Sport, because they came up and threw up a last minute Hail Mary pass and got us some funding, which we end up having to use to just pay back money that you have already borrowed. Mm-hmm. Right, and Mr. Douglas calls, he had surgery on his both knees, and he calls almost every day to find out, you sure you all don't need anything leading up? Even the new president, Mr. Ramasar, we haven't always seen eye to eye, but now he's working feverishly to try to get whatever. He calls me and like, you need anything you need, you would call me, which I am grateful for, because I'm not business about my personal feelings and your personal feelings. What I want to know is that whatever we're doing is the best for the athlete, and full stop. If what you're doing is not best for the athlete, that's full stop. I don't want to deal with you, and that's the way it goes.
Okay, we have to take another break. When I come back, I just want to talk about track and field in Trinidad and Tobago. Are we growing or are we stagnant? Are we declining? And I'm basing that on our one gold medal, on our one bronze medal. I'm thinking that you come back with the gold, so or one bronze medal from the Olympics. And we are hearing a lot of negative things. To be honest, I heard Otto Boland on CNC3, he said that if you cannot make the first rounds in an Olympic, you should stay home and do not go as a tourist. That was his words, right? I think it was a bit harsh, but I would like to hear your views on that.
I would love to give you my views on some of the earlier things that I said, is that the poor performance we had at this Olympics, and it was a poor performance, is based on a callaloo of stuff. And Trinidadians will understand exactly what I mean by a callaloo, because basically some of the reasons why we didn't get medals was because of injuries, stuff that you couldn't foresee, right? The athlete wasn't 100%, right? Which, okay, it happens in the sport, right? Some of the stuff was people with the wrong mentality. They think that, okay, yeah, I'm big, I could shut it down right here. And then somebody coming who didn't think they were big, struck their torso in and put you out of the next rounds, right? And then it had some stuff with some terrible luck, right? Like the 4x4 men relay team, which was one of the best chances for a medal, right? It had a little incident, a man stepped off the track, stepped out of his lane a little bit, right? With the men 4x1, right? It's a combination of things, right? But the thing is, the reason that we didn't get the kind of medals that we expected is not for the fault of, I hear plenty of people blaming the management and the team and the government and the all kind of stuff, right? Everybody has a bit of responsibility to shoulder for what's going on, right? But the athletes have to take responsibility as well, right? I believe that. I'm good with some of the athletes, so I don't go meet me down the road and tell me how I go say that, boy, mm-hmm. you understand? But mm-hmm. I already said that I give Jack his jacket, and I would speak about some if I'm not sure. Only fools speak things that they know of, and I don't consider myself a fool in any day, mm-hmm. right? So what basically happens is when you have a program, as far as the government side is concerned, when you have a program that doesn't find any new talent, the ones that you have are going to grow old, right? They're not going to be as resilient, and you're going to have poor performances, right? When you have athletes that can't even, they qualified for their funding or not qualified for their funding, or they can't work because they're trying to get themselves ready, right? But they can't eat because they can't work because they're trying to get themselves ready. They're going to underperform. Their nutrition is not going to be right. Their mind is not going to be right. They're going to underperform, right? So which means you have the people that tell you, say they're going to give you some support, to blame for some of that, right? The programs, you have the government to blame for some of that. But then you also have the athletes who go to these meets, right? And you know you're not ready, and waste the government's money to go over there, right? Or you spend so much time studying to sightsee and take pictures and stuff like that, and then you underperform. Or then you thought you were better than you was, and you end up out. So there's a whole lot of different things. And what it is, I heard people talking about the chef not being there and mm-hmm. stuff like that. Mm-hmm. I believe that the chef should be there. But if it is, I am in a house and I live with my family. If I leave to go to work on any given day, my whole house is not supposed to blow up and disappear.
Yeah.
Right? If it is one cog in this oil machine that they wanted to call Trinidad and Tobago team, could cause the whole team not to get any medals, then the team had no business going there. Right? Better than to send the one cog alone. You understand? It has its part to play, yes. If it caused it to be 1/100 of a second slower, right? Or a dollar shorter, that's right. But it can't cause every wheel to fall off. If you don't put oil in your vehicle, it will cause the engine damage, and it will call the whole car.
Because we also heard in a short interview that with Kishon that he referred to the team wasn't as gelled as 2012. You understand? We are still waiting on him to come back, you know, to maybe for the entire nation to question him to find out what he meant by that. Mm-hmm. But surely, if you had to read between the lines, they looked like there was some, you know, issues.
Coming off of the previous performance of previous years, what you would find is people who are not managed properly get swell-headed, right? I have been at these championships and just in the warm-up area and listening to some of these athletes speak, right? Some of the management team speak, and some of them believe that they have arrived, right? So you would find athletes that, I don't want to run this leg, I don't want to do that relay, I don't want to run with them, right? When this is a national team and the team's supposed to have control over it, and then you have people who would be on the team that's saying, okay, well, they normally pick it for themselves and it work, right? Or well, them is big man, so they can handle it, right? Which means it puts a false sense of we can handle this on our own, in the athlete's pocket, right? And when all these things keep happening, obviously you're going to gel because, okay, if it's you one of the big men who are performing well, right? And the country's looking towards you. And I want my friend to run and not you. No, I'm not going to gel with you because I know quietly you don't really want me to get my chance to run at an Olympics, right? There's plenty of different things that could cause that jealousy. That's some of the stuff that I have personally seen, right? I don't know what Keyshawn particularly was referring to because he would have seen his different things right there. I don't know if it's all the coaches wouldn't agree and, you know, different stuff, but as I keep saying is that it takes a team and a well-oiled one to get athletes to perform. And if you send a unwell-oiled team, be it athletes or management, that's what you're going to get.
Well, I know you are sending a well-oiled athlete to the Paralympics. From where you sit, what do you expect her to accomplish at Rio?
I would say one more word again. You remember I said I like to say mindset?
Yeah.
I'm programming my athlete to go over there and not just win a gold medal, but break a world record. So if at any point in time your foot slipped in the blocks or you had a bad day, you have to get one or the other. Mm-hmm. So you might get a silver and a world record or a gold without the world record or both of them.
Yeah.
Right? When I send you out there to get two medals and you know that you are prepared, you understand? If you don't get two gold, you might get a gold and a silver, a gold and a bronze, two silvers, right? I could safely say, based on the team that is going over there, I expect that the Paralympics team will come back with more hardware than the team that receives all the support from the country, the government, and corporate Trinidad, right? These are the only accumulated triple world record holder, and he has no sponsors. That's madness.
Yeah.
When the other counterparts of herself, who she beat, sponsored by Toyota, Kellogg's, British Petroleum, Nike, Adidas, Puma, you understand? And I expect that they're going to outperform all their counterparts who have more because they're going out there with a mentality that we have something to prove, right? I'm going to get in trouble for saying what I'm going to say next, but I think that Trinidad and Tobago track and field has too much free money. Right, athletes feel I have been sitting with athletes who were getting funding a few years ago. We were at a meet in Europe, and the statement one of the guys made, "Yo, I don't need the government money. You know, I just carry to buy my diamonds." And then on the other side of the coin, I've met people like Emmanuel Kalender, who has been on every national team since 2008, who has been struggling to make sure he get food to train and stuff because me and Calendar good sometimes. He say, yo, just do some therapy for my boy, I'll go pay you later. You understand? And so on and so forth. And
he's one of the athletes I always look up to and really, you know, you can see the country in him.
He's one of the most hardest working, but he's one of those that has the most on his mind, most on his back, most on his shoulders, right? Because how you could concentrate on competing at the highest level when you always have a study, how you're going to eat and how you're going to get to here and how you're going to get to there, right? There are other athletes like Richard. I am not going to lambast Richard for his performance because I have been to Richard's house. I have seen what Richard is going through to try to get himself back, right? He's very blessed to at least make it to the Olympics, right? Because I know he had a very, very hard road, right? Jay, you have a hard road on injuries and stuff like that, right?
But he's still young. He has a great opportunity of...
So all the bad performances, as I would look straight in the camera and say to Trinidad and Tobago, all the bad performances that you've seen at the Olympics, some of them could not be helped, and some of these athletes did the best with what they had and what they could pull off at the time. Right, but some of them just did not. Some of the management team, they work hard, right? And some of them just did not. So you can't bunch the whole of them. You just have to find a proper manner in which you can dissect who didn't, which cog did not spin where they're supposed to spin, and which cog did. It's as simple as that.
Okay. Before we wrap up, Nayo, let me just get you on the spot here. There are a lot of young people who might be suffering from slight disorders and whatever. given the opportunity, what will you tell these individuals right now? Because, you know, for instance, you said when you were growing up, they call you hop and drop and whatever. There might be other athletes who might be given that same title, but they are not strong enough to come to get out of that, and they might be suffering in a little vacuum. They have the talent, but there is no motivational factor. What would you tell that individual?
I would say, see yourself surpass your disability. Do not study. Yes, you have a disability. You know you have a disability. You don't need anybody to tell you have a disability. But see yourself as a normal person. See yourself having everything like everybody else have. Mm. And whatever you have and whatever you are passionate about, you work towards that. Once you have people supporting you, you work towards that. And you will achieve it, because whatever you put your mind to do, mm-hmm. and whatever you have in your heart to do, you mm-hmm. will do it. Mm-hmm. So once you know, hey, I am normal and I could do this, because scripture says,
I can do all things,
right? And even
through Christ. So
if you're a Christian, don't worry yourself, you have God with you. So all you need to do is know that
you can do all things through Christ. And he never said, those who have a disability or those who normal, those who pretty, those who,
he never said that. He said,
you can do all things through Christ, right? And you could do it. So believe in yourself first. Don't look to anybody else.
Believe in yourself first. Mm-hmm. Know that you could do it, and you push towards your goal.
What would you like to leave with Trinidad and Tobago?
I am super excited. I'm also excited to make this country all jolly again, and, you know, just to be able to focus on athletes once more. To
come
depend.
Up with all the medals, yes. And get $2.5 million, get a house, you know?
No, but I am excited to represent a community mm. of disabled athletes,
yeah,
right? And to show people that we are all equal. Yes, every creed and
every
race
finds an equal,
find
yeah.
equal place. Mm. So I believe that everybody could find an equal place, and that's what I am representing. And I would like to go on the national stage, international stage, and mm. show people that disabled athletes could do it. Mm-hmm. So I just want to go, win the gold, come back, smile for the cameras, say Trinidad.
Win the double gold. Win the double.
Yes. Not the proclaim gold. It. Yes. Declare it.
Right. You are going to win the goal, and the thing you're going to be associated with Aileen Thompson.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. Now, yes, you have really improved thanks to your coach, thanks to the program, and thanks to God for bringing you to this point. And, coach, we want to really thank you for taking this individual, seeing what she had in her, and helping her to accomplish what she's going to accomplish. And even beyond her athletic career, what she's going to do now is going to motivate other young people with disorders. Yes. Sometimes you might not know who you have touched, but you are going to. So again, thank you very much.
Thank you.
We wish you all the best.
Thank you.
And we support you 100%. If you miss any part of this program, remember it's a repeat tomorrow at 1 p.m. You can catch us on Axe TV at Tuesday night between the hours of 8 to 9. What more can we say? Thank you again. We hope that Trinidad Tobago will rally around her when she comes back with that success. And we look forward to her in the future, bringing other Paralympics and other young people who might be suffering from whatever disorder out of that shell, and they can come forward and follow in her footsteps. So again, thank you very much. We hope you have a blessed week ahead. We look forward to seeing you next week, Tuesday, 8 p.m., right here on this channel.